proper in his ears. The full knowledge of the majesty and power of dragons suddenly filled him, and he fell to his knees, weeping to think that he had dared defy such magnificent creatures. All around him men were doing the same, begging for forgiveness and promising lifelong servitude, if only they were spared. They knelt or prostrated themselves in the mud. Hest himself stood, his arms uplifted to the sky, and suddenly realized he was shouting praise to their beauty. In the distance, the dragons were beginning a wheeling turn. He knew two things with certainty. This time they returned to kill. And then, with an even greater clarity, he knew that the thoughts and feelings of the past few moments were not his own. It's like a dream, he told himself. The dream in which I do and say things I would never do or say in my waking life. This is not me. This is not of my own will. Then as the dragons approached, the rational thought fled. Every human who could leave the ships had. Sintaro was vaguely aware of them wailing in trapped dismay. Some were jumping about, heedless of how they damaged themselves as they fought chains that secured them to rowing benches. Humans evidently confined humans. Why, she could not guess, and did not find it intriguing enough to puzzle about. It did not please her when Merkel led them to land in the shallows of the river, and then wade ashore, but she sensed his purpose. The humans were now cut off from their ships. A few, she knew, fled mindlessly into the forest. They would die there, tonight or tomorrow. Humans were not able to live without shelter and food. But others crouched in the grasses or hid behind trees, or simply prostrated themselves, sick with terror. Not one had been killed by tooth or claw or dragon's breath. Those who had perished brought their own deaths, their little minds unable to stand before the terrible glamour of a dragon's wrath and majesty. As the dragons waded out of the river, some of their captives wailed in terror. Then Hebe spoiled their grand procession out of the water by skidding to a halt on the mud bank, sending muck up in a splattering spray over the cowering humans. Sintaro snorted in disdain. She noticed that Rapsco did not leap down from the Scarlet Dragon's back until she had moved to a less marshy site. Then he hopped down, his gay outline cloak a flutter about his shoulders. Those few invaders who were capable of a response other than terror gasped in awe at the sight of him. Grudgingly, she had to admit that he looked far grander than the squat humans in their murky clothes. Tall and slender, he was a fitting companion to the dragons. He looked about, a grim smile on his face, then flung his cloak back over one shoulder. She felt almost proud of him as he strode forward and thought of the humans. Stand up! Come forward! It is time to be judged by those you have wronged.